You need to turn the music off. If I hit mute, it's gonna mute everything.
I don't know. It should be just music mute. Let me see. You ready for your volume? Yeah.
No, that's really.
You want your volume up yet or not?
Should we say testing? Like, do you need us to test our mics?
I'll test them.
Today, I believe in the possibility of love. That is why I endeavor to trace its imperfections, its perversions. Frantz Fanon.
The moment we choose to love, we begin to move against domination, against oppression. The moment we choose to love, we begin to move towards freedom, to act in ways that liberate ourselves and others. That action is the testimony of love as the practice of freedom. Bell Hooks.
Love is big. Love can hold anger. Love can even hold hatred. It's about the intention of what you want it to do. Alice Walker.
I've learned not to worry about love, but to honor its coming with all my heart. Alice Walker.
Don't ever think I fell for you or fell over you. I didn't fall in love. I rose in it. Toni Morrison.
We make love. We build it, we break it, and we remake it over and over again.
Love is a practice. It is what we do. Love is a guiding force, a methodology that moves us closer to freedom and in new directions. And love is deliberate, as in, I loved you on purpose. Good evening, and welcome to the 2017 Women's History Month keynote and Mary Lynn Morgan Lecture, Making Love, Sex Positivity, Anti-Violence, and the Making of Healthy Intimacies. Tonight, we are going to explore sex positivity, the idea that sex is a healthy part of human life and that your choices around sex, whatever they may be, should be affirmed. We are going to talk about the anti-violence movement and the way that we can break down and create new social norms to prevent violence against women. And we are going to think about the role of love, what it means to love right now, to use love as a guiding practice in this time, during these moments of so much resistance. For as Che Guevara said, the revolutionary is guided by great feelings of love. So I say, so too is the revolution. We began this evening with pop-ups around love from members of the Praxis Center for Women and Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies Student Leadership Board. This unique leadership board works to blend feminist theories and practices by influencing the people we get to bring to campus. I want to thank them for picking such an interesting and captivating topic for this year's keynote and selecting such exciting speakers. And if you're interested in joining Praxis, applications will open tomorrow. I also want to thank the Center for Women staff and student workers, especially Tiffany, who worked with Praxis this year. And thank you to the Department of Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies. A special thank you to Tia Williams, who also worked with Praxis. I think this is an exciting way to cap another Women's History Month. And what a month we've had. Many women participated in A Day Without a Woman for International Women's Day on March 8th. Last weekend, we celebrated 100 years of women at Emory. The Center for Women is embarking on its 25-year anniversary, and now we will talk about love. In just a moment, you will hear from our speakers for the evening, sex educator Marla Renee Stewart, and filling in for you, Lester Douglas, who unfortunately had an emergency and sends his sincere regrets, will be Lee Giordano, who is the Director of Training for Men Stopping Violence. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Marla. Marla is a professional sex, intimacy, and relationship coach and sex educator. Gaining her reputation for being the sex architect, she created Velvet Lips, LLC, to empower people of all ages to embrace, educate, and enjoy their sexuality and their sexual lives. She has studied human sexuality for more than 13 years at San Francisco State University and Georgia State University, which is where I had the pleasure of meeting her during my master's work there, respectively, and has expert knowledge in a wide variety of subjects. She has published academic articles and continues to do sexuality research. She has conducted workshops at conferences, not-for-profit, and private organizations, as well as universities in the Atlanta area. She has also been featured on many radio shows, documentaries, books, magazines, and has been invited to speak at universities around the country. If you ask her what she does, she'll tell you she, quote, helps people get in tune with their body and have phenomenal and divine orgasms, end quote. Those are her words. We went to dinner with Marla yesterday, a small group of students, and we had a phenomenal time. She is dynamic, exciting, brilliant, and fun, and this conversation is sure to be a treat. Lee Giordano is a community organizer and violence prevention advocate interested in building and sustaining communities of men dedicated to using anti-oppression frameworks to end male violence against women. As the director of training at Men Stopping Violence, Lee designs, organizes, and conducts trainings, workshops, and webinars on oppression and violence against women. Lee co-developed the programs, curriculum, and trainings currently being used by Men Stopping Violence. Also a graduate of Georgia State University with a Bachelor's of Science in Sociology and a minor in Women's Studies, Lee received his master's degree in social justice education from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. I had the pleasure of working with Lee last year when Men Stopping Violence came in and put on a workshop for us. He was incredibly thoughtful in his responses and has a true skill in helping people get it. He will return to Emory next month as part of the Sexual Assault Awareness Month. Our speakers will give you more detail about how they began doing this work. Then we will move into a 30-minute moderated conversation with me, Chanel Pratt-Tanner, Assistant Director of the Center for Women at Emory, and also a PhD candidate in Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies. And then we will have a 30-minute audience Q&A, giving you the opportunity to ask the panelists questions. At the end of the event, there will be a reception right next door in the Oxford Living Room space. So at this time, we'll go ahead and get started. So I think we'll just start with you, Lee, if you could just tell us, I'm forgetting my paper, but if you could tell us a little bit more about who you are and how you got started doing this kind of work.
Okay, thanks. So good evening, everyone. Good to be here. I got started in the work in college as an undergraduate in the late 90s, and I was interested in doing a lot of different social justice organizing work and activism. I was interested in racial justice. We were doing a lot of work around freeing Mumia Abu-Jamal, some police brutality cases here locally, some other political prisoner work. And as I was doing that work, I wasn't very self-aware of how I was showing up in those spaces. And a group of women who I was very close with, who cared a lot about me, who I cared about, challenged me around how I was taking up space and dominating space. And luckily, about them stopping violence. So they encouraged me to go check it out and talk to the co-founder, Dick Bathrick. And I went reluctantly, thinking, you know, I can go read a book and learn about what I need to versus really doing much else. But when I had a conversation with Dick, I really realized the power that Men Stopping Violence had that they would make available for me. And they were really focused on self-awareness, and before I could go out into the community and do work, I really had to look at myself and sort of get myself in line. So I did an internship there and fell deeper in love with the work. I started facilitating their intervention classes, and that's one of the things that Men Stopping Violence is known for. That's one of the things that they began doing 35 years ago when it was founded. They would intervene with men who were abusive to women. I really enjoyed that. I saw education as transformative and wanted to deepen my understanding, and so I went away to grad school at UMass, as you heard. At UMass, I broadened my horizons a bit, but really started to understand how transformative the work in Men Stopping Violence could be. And their analysis of the need to educate men and seeing the men who come to our classes who have used abusive behavior as potential change agents is something that I think is the kind of work that I want to be doing. It's the kind of transformation I want to be a part of. It's the kind of transformation that I went through, and so I think it really has a liberatory function in our larger movements. So after coming back from grad school, I began as working with you, Lester, in the training department, and currently am working as a director of training.
And Marla, how did you become a sex artist?
Well,
Lester
was many ways, but one of them is through, I think, the seed planted by my mother. My mother was very much into sex education and wanting to educate me about everything there is to know about sex as a young person, I think starting from second grade and on. And so from that point, when I got to college, I noticed that all my friends were constantly asking me about sex and sexuality and having orgasms, and I really, like I told you yesterday, I really learned how my friends weren't having orgasms and how it was a problem for me, right? Because you think about, like, orgasms are great and they're wonderful and they put you in this wonderful bliss, yet you are not experiencing that. And for me, sexual energy is, you know, a lot and can be sublimated throughout any parts of your life, right? So I think from then, as an undergrad studying psychology, human sexuality, and LGBT studies, I went on to pursue sort of sexual studies and came to Georgia, where sort of everything blossomed, I would say. So I came to grad school here, studying sociology with the emphasis on gender and sexuality. And from then on, I really realized how important sort of intersectionality was. I realized how important marginalized folks, their perspectives and how they were important and how it informs all types of work. And so from then on, I've just been, I guess, navigating life through this lens. So I was in the School of Public Health, and I did some HIV testing and research there. My own research was on alternative sexual modalities within for folks of color. From then on, I moved to just volunteering and helping, and because I was volunteering and helping with people or groups such as, like, Solutions Not Punishment Coalition, I just volunteered and my services, my research, the things that I could do. And I went from there. But as far as, like, my education business, my sexuality education business, actually one of my best friends here in the audience encouraged me to actually get started with the business. And actually, while I was in grad school, she told me, she's like, what are you waiting for? And I really realized, like, what am I waiting for? Am I waiting for some sort of bat signal, you know? I shouldn't be waiting for anything. I should start it now. And I should start helping people now. And I did some workshops here and there, Agnes Scott Spellman, around safe sex. And then from there, just formed the business and started doing workshops and helping people, not only with their sex lives, but communication, and just really helping them to embody what is power, what is love, and helping them to see how that can influence them in their life. So
can you both talk a little bit about the history and the significance of the movements that you situate yourselves in, and how do you define sex positivity, and how are you defining intimate partner violence?
Sure. So when I think about this, I really think about, I also sit on a couple of boards. I sit on Spark Reproductive Justice Now and Atlanta Harm Reduction Coalition. And so when I think about these movements, I think about, a lot of times I'm thinking about all the different marginalized folks, how they're using their bodies, how they're having access to resources. I'm really thinking about how I can be in service, helpful, use my privilege in order to help anybody that I can in this movement. So...
How do you define sex positivity?
Well, sex positivity for me is being able to love who you want, being able to be sexually liberated, and use that liberation as a force for knowing your pleasure as well as other people's pleasure. I think it's about, for me, it's about freedom. You know, it is not getting away from stigma, getting away from shame, and into the realms of pleasure, joy, love, creation. That's what sex positivity is for me.
You have, I'm curious to, like, what is the intervention it's making, or, like, what movement is it a part of? Is feminist? Is that the only movement that it's, like, coming from, or, like, really the term, right? Like, hippies didn't call themselves, they just doing what they wanted to do, right?
Like, the love revolution, right?
Right, yeah, like, so when did we get to this place of saying sex positivity?
That's a great question. I mean, I really don't know exactly, but I think we, as a society, I think we've been so sex negative, I think, to counteract that negativity, or to be revolutionary, we have to turn it around, right? So to sex positive. So I think that's probably the reason why it went from sex negative to sex positive, getting away from stigma, shame, oppression, and moving into pleasure, joy, desire. So, yeah.
Can I comment?
Yes, please.
I think your last one is really excellent, coming from my perspective. We've only ever thought about sex as we've got to stop sexual violence, we've got to stop sex abuse. And so we haven't been able to think about what sex positive is, or not to say we, but a lot of the movement hasn't done that thinking. And so we've been very reactionary, and particularly with our work with men, we don't really know how to have a conversation with them about how to be sex positive. We know what to tell them not to do. But I think your work
Yeah, and a comment on that too. I think because of the research that I was doing throughout my undergrad and master's, you know, it really, what I noticed is that things that were being funded were always sex negative, right? So, like, what is stigma and shame, and how that affecting, and abuse and violence, and nothing that was positive was being funded, right? There was no money for people who were thinking about pleasure, joy, desire, and love, right? So what does it mean to, built in the system of capitalism, right? What does it mean to fund things that are negative versus funding things that are positive?
Yeah. I mean, what you were just saying, Lee, made me wonder how much violence against women is around trying to control their sexual selves.
No, I think in general, women aren't seen as they're not supposed to be in control of their sexual selves. And so our analysis, and I'll talk about the history and I guess we'll come back around to that. But our analysis really centers patriarchy and colonialism as the root of violence against women. And interpersonal violence is the social control that individuals use to ensure that patriarchy and colonialism stay as the overarching structure of oppression. So we can talk about the ways that women's sexuality is controlled and marginalized through things like, you know, religion, courts, media, but we can also look very specifically at how individuals are also policing in interpersonal relationships. Men, in heterosexual interpersonal relationships, men are policing women's sexuality. It's, you know, from, you mentioned the program we have in a couple of weeks where we're going to look at the whole spectrum that goes, you know, from rape and murder down to harassment and reinforcing some of those negative sex negative beliefs.
So, yeah, can you say more about men stopping violence?
Sure. Yeah. So, men stopping violence was founded in 1982. It was founded by two men, Dick Bathrick and Gus Kaufman. They were aware of the movement to end violence against women, or the battered women's movement, as it was called then, that had really started to pick up steam, and they wanted, as men, to participate, to support the movement in some way. They were both therapists, and so they approached a woman, Catherine McFarland, who worked at a shelter in Cobb County, and said, "We want to help battered women." And their thinking was more on, you know, how can we provide direct services to battered women? But at the time, there was really a shift taking place where people were thinking, you know, because men are the primary perpetrators of violence, it should be men who are intervening with those perpetrators of violence. So they were encouraged to start a battery intervention class. And that was something that was pretty new. They were popping up around the country, but this was the first in this area. And so that's what they did. They began their training, began honing their practice, and we've been offering one ever since. But the movement has really shifted to less of a focus on intervention and even sort of a negative perspective on intervention, and more towards, and more resources and funding being put towards prevention. And which, that's an important transition where, you know, we shouldn't just be responding to violence after it's occurred. We should be thinking about how do we prevent people from experiencing the violence. But what we've tried to do, and I think what's unique about Men Stopping Violence nationally, is that we're trying to mold the two together, that we think that we can do intervention and prevention at the same time. Through focusing on adult men, that we can, like I said earlier, going through the class for 24 weeks, they're learning a lot about violence against women. They're learning a lot about themselves and how they've used controlling behaviors. And so we, you know, often in our communities, when people think about violence against women or interpersonal violence, they're very focused on the physical violence that occurs. The criminal legal system is generally only going to respond, if it responds at all, to the physical abuse. And so we're training men to understand the whole spectrum. We're training men to understand how patriarchy and colonialism are the anchors that hold violence against women in place. And so with that training, just because they have been abusive, if they've made choices to be accountable, to work on ending their abuse, and be safer, then they're excellent candidates to be advocates out in the community talking with other men. And so that's really where how our work has transformed over the years, and that's one of our primary interventions into the larger movement is to get people to shift their thinking a little bit. Even if we could never say that a man who goes through our class is safer and will never be abusive again, we can look at these classes as opportunities for community change, and that's what we're really going after.
So just a few minutes ago, you two started to see connections between the things that you're doing. And so I'm wondering, how important are allies to the work that you do, and how do you go about building those strong coalitions?
I think it's always about finding what you have in common, right? Yeah. So thinking about coalition building, allies, what is it that connects me to you? There's going to be something. And I feel, for me, that's why I'm a connector in general, because I'm able to make these connections between different people. Like, hey, your work informs my work informs your work. We can work together and show people that these things are intimately connected, and that can expand and sort of vibrate, you know, into different realms. So,
and I think we've really positioned ourselves as allies, knowing that in order to do this work as men, that we need to make sure that we're looking to leaders in the battered women's movement who are women, who are people of color, who are queer, that can inform our work. And so I think we've got a great practice at Men's Talking Violence of how we show up as allies so that we can participate in coalitions. I think one of the places that we're really trying to show up currently is down at the Capitol. And in our organizing model, one of the things that we're often asked for is, can you send men that will come talk to representatives and senators that can help with some of the awful legislation that harms women or support some of the legislation that supports women? And that's one place that we found that through working with the other DB agencies in the area, we can be effective. It's also, I think, the challenge for us is it's hard to, sometimes we can't show up for all the bills that we want to, or there's different organizations that we see ourselves allied to that are in opposition to different bills. So one good example of what really makes this coalition or coalition work tough is there's the campus sexual assault bill that's going on right now. It's progressing right now. And so we've come out pretty strongly against it. The whole coalition of DB organizations and sexual assault organizations have come out against it. But the sponsor who is supporting us at the Capitol from the House is also the person who is pushing forward the campus carry bill. So there's this really strange partnership now where we agreed to be in partnership with her before she announced that she was going to sponsor this other bill. And then we were put in a position where we look like we're supporting her in some way, but completely not in support of the campus carry bill. And so that's the sort of thing that makes coalition working with coalition really tough, because we're having to make decisions about how do we continue to support one part of the coalition, who's responsible for a mistake like this, and ultimately it could have just torn the organizing that needed to happen around the sexual assault bill apart.
So you're bringing up going to the Capitol and the different bills that you all have been pushing against, and I'm curious to know how this current presidential administration and the political climate has impacted, or how you foresee it impacting the work that you're trying to do.
I go back and forth a bit, where there's a part of me that's completely discouraged by hearing the things that he said that is basically admitting to sexual assault of women and promoting sexual assault of women, and seeing the impact that it has on my conversations with men, and one of the things that's been really hard for some men is how obvious it is that there's different justice based on your socioeconomic status or your race. And so we're saying to men, you know, and we know that sometimes the criminal legal system is unjust, but you know, if you've been referred to our class through the criminal legal system, there's something you can really learn here. And the majority of men buy into that, say, okay, you know what, I'll get what I can while I'm here. But then they see this man who represents someone, you know, I guess represents power in our country, they can just get away with it. And that really should illuminate a lot for, it illuminates a lot for me about what we're actually saying when we're saying we're working to end violence against women, when we rely completely or almost completely on the criminal legal system as the solution for violence against women, that actually we're only policing certain communities that are always the communities that are policed. And ultimately we're sending the message that controlling women is okay if you have power, social power, but some people shouldn't have that same amount of power. And so I think that's been really disheartening for men to really to see examples of so strongly. But the other part of me, it remembers before Trump was president that the media always justified and excused. And I think about Brock Turner and how the court, the Stanford rape case, completely blew it with his sentence, and that's not out of the ordinary. So I have to remind myself that the work is very similar to what it's always been. It's just maybe a little bit more in your face now. And that might actually be a good thing. That not that he's saying what he's doing, but the fact that it's a little bit more apparent may actually help us have conversations we need to have.
Yeah, I agree. Really just bringing it into light. I have so many thoughts for the most part, I think that we need more marginalized folks in politics and to help influence our laws and policies. And we just don't. We just don't have enough. And there's an overwhelming amount of white, aging, baby boomers who are controlling our laws and policies right now. So until they die off, you know, it is what it is. And so I feel like sometimes I have to navigate this system where I kind of like don't even think about navigating the system. I'm kind of like, I'm just going to do my own thing until this change occurs. So that's sort of how I feel about the whole administration.
Yeah, I think we all have the new thought. Being recorded. So Marla, how do we talk about sex positivity without reinscribing some patriarchal or heterosexual norms?
I think we talk about it in terms of just love and behavior, right? So we can talk about sex positivity in a way of, like, this is what I want to do, or I feel like giving very, I think leaving it open, like giving very general statements, talking about people in non-binary terms, right? We're not talking about men and women, we're talking about people, right? We're not talking about heterosexuality or homosexuality, we're talking about sexuality. We're talking about behaviors, things we love to do, things we enjoy, and talking about it in a way that is very general, open, understanding, and accepted, right? Because we all do things very much differently. So I think being able to get out of binary thinking is a way to enforce sex positivity.
So for you, Lee, I'm wondering if you could speak to the ways that toxic masculinity shows up in LGBTQ spaces.
Well, one of our foundational beliefs is that all men are socialized to absorb patriarchal teachings. So, you know, while I mostly talk to heterosexual men in places where men have been abusive, we also have gay men who come to our classes and are a part of our organization, obviously. And it's very clear that they have work similar to my work of interrogating our belief systems and seeing where we have absorbed some of that patriarchal teaching. And as a man, I think any of us can find quickly how we've been taught to dominate space or to be that agent of social control in women's lives. And I think that work should be happening regardless of sexual orientation.
Yeah, I was thinking about, I don't know if y'all are familiar with the rapper Young and May. Right. And like how on the one hand we want to celebrate her as a woman that's killing it, but on the other hand when you really look at some toxic masculinity happening in her lyrics, and so I was just thinking about how oftentimes folks think those spaces are free of those problems, but you see it show up in other spaces as well.
Oh, go ahead.
I'd also say that it's also one of the, like, those spaces, like queer-led spaces, are also the places that we look to figure out how do we redefine masculinity. Because I think there's a lot of people who are thinking about masculinity in much more transformative ways than we have been thinking about it. We're just now, as a movement, shifting from thinking about from going from toxic masculinity to healthy masculinity, and it's either we're going to go from this bad thing to this one good thing. And I think the conversation that's happening in more LGBT spaces is more about all the different possibilities of masculinity and who can perform this masculinity. And so our work, our movement is pretty far behind that. And we're trying to just create this other one healthy masculinity that then everyone is going to be forced into doing. So that's going to be as problematic. Maybe a little bit softer, but as problematic as where we currently are.
So when I hear the term toxic masculinity, I always think whose truth this is, right? And the people who coined the term are aging old white men, you know? And so for me, this toxic masculinity, right, is this idea that these guys came up with that is just kind of like, I have to question it in general. Because your power dynamics usually are not for me or for my people. And I think as a feminist, a black feminist, a womanist, like, thinking about who my communities are, like, am I really going to subscribe to something that is used to racialize people, right? So when we think about toxic masculinity, it's interesting to see you come back to sort of Young and May. And so we think of, like, black masculinity. Right, our minds are so colonized. When they talk about toxic masculinity, they say, "Oh, it's because these men are raised by women." Yeah. When you think about single motherhood, who do you think of? You think of single black mothers. Period, point blank. Right. So our minds are constantly colonized. We think about these things, and they're racialized, but they're not. They don't speak race in the text. They speak race in our minds. And so I often have to think about, like, what does it really mean to be, what is toxic masculinity saying? Who is this speaking to? Is this the same rhetoric we've been speaking since slavery?
Mm-hmm. So how do we get outside of that then?
Oof. I think looking to people who are the people in power. Looking to people who are marginalized, looking to people who are redefining masculinity, looking to people who are redefining what is gender. And I think you would find that, but you need to ask those people, be in community with those people.
I think one of the most vocational classes, plays. They provide a space for men to come and learn about violence against women and patriarchy, but also the structure of the class breaks down some of the norms of toxic masculinity. So we have role models in the class who are able to engage their feelings, able to be authentic, to be vulnerable around other men. And one of the things that really surprised me early on was that I started hearing men talk about how important the class was, because they feel like they could walk through the door and let go of a lot of what they felt was this extra baggage or feeling like they had to be guarded around other men. And so, you know, it, like you were saying, I really believe that toxic masculinity only works for a very few, or traditional masculinity only works for a very small subset of men. When even men like me, who are a heterosexual, middle-class, white men, we can pretty quickly look at how actually it's not in my best interest to try to live my life to these ideals. And just providing that space, I think, has a transformative function.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think the opposite side of, like, the sex positivity side to that would be, like, groups like Black Men Smile.
Yeah.
Right? Like, seeing Black men smile, like, heterosexual Black men in spaces where they are complimenting each other and saying, like, hey, this is how we show love for each other.
Mm-hmm.
And how that's the very much sort of opposite of this toxic masculinity.
Yeah. I think I'm getting close to... I'm gonna open it up to you all to see if you have questions. I, of course, have more, but let's see. The audience has some questions.
I have two questions. One for you, Marla. I've always been curious. I've known you. We've known each other for a long time. And so I'm curious about, what does it mean for you as a Black woman to be doing sex education work? Being a sex architect, given the historical context in the United States of just us as a society and as a culture now respecting Black women's bodies, and not respecting Black women's sexuality.
Well, number one, I think it's a very lonely space for me. I think being one of the only people here that is actually doing sort of education and, you know, embracing sex positivity, it's been a very lonely place in my academic, you know, life and in my business life. And I also think that it, because it has been such sort of a lonely space, that gives me room to plant the seeds that I need to plant to be innovative in the way that I talk to people, in the way that I help people learn, educate, empower. And with the, I guess, historical context, it's really about reclaiming, right? So, my body is not necessarily for everybody else, right? My body is for me. And because I am a subject and I'm using my agency to show my body in the ways that I show my body, if I want to do whatever I need to do, I'm showing you and using that agency. And that is helping me to show people how liberated they can be. Sexually or otherwise. Right. Does that answer?
Yeah, totally. Thank you so much. And Lee, you know, I was sort of hearing you talk about just like men stopping violence and, you know, getting that this is like, you know, kind of hosted by women and gender studies. And just like, I'm curious, like, at your organization and within your movement, I think you touched on it a little bit, but just as the category of gender is expanding and becoming more expansive, right? When we think of like trans men, you know, people who identify as men or don't identify as men, people who are non-binary, people who are intersex men, you know, who still kind of internalize patriarchy and domination and sexism, right? Who are not sort of free of those things. Like, is the conversation expanding as these categories are expanding?
I think it is. I don't think we're on the cutting edge interested in wanting to be a part of those conversations and exploring those conversations. But I also don't think we have much of a choice. And I would say years ago, we started to have a conversation. You know, would our class be appropriate for a trans man who's been abusive, or a trans intern who wants to go through the class or something like that? And there was some real debate, like, you know, would this be the right thing to do? Would it be ethical? And you know, it's problematic in a lot of ways. But before we came to a conclusion, we had a person come through our class who identified as outside the gender binary and felt like this is the class for them. And so we said, okay, you know, they made the case, we followed their lead. We learned a lot through that process. We're still thinking back on it, and next time, how will we approach it? And having conversations with our people we see ourselves allied to about how we should handle it. So I think we're a work in progress in that sense.
Just a follow-up.
Yeah.
What are some of the things that y'all learned in that process?
So we've always, and I would say the movement in general, has had a very binary mindset, right? And, even in how we, like I was saying earlier about what masculinity looks like, reinscribing some pretty problematic viewpoints of what a good husband is or what a good man is. And, you know, there's this idea that, you know, if you're using abusive behavior in your family, then you're not the right kind of patriarch. You need to be a patriarch that rules with and so it's like those concepts of gender sort of fall away when we're expanding it beyond this binary idea of gender. And just knowing that there's, again, like I said earlier, so many different ways of doing masculinity that in some ways we were guarded against. We were, I don't want to say threatened, but maybe that, you know, it sort of threatens all of our masculinity when we open it up too far. And I think it really threatens a movement that's heterosexist in a lot of ways to have these conversations and to think about these three classes. And it's in opposition to norms that we've had that were set up and fought for that are really productive, right? So there's standards that say you can't have a class with men and with women. And we can think about how unsafe that could be because we could potentially have abusive men and victims in the same class, right? And so there's a really good reason for that. But then we can also go back and say, well, you know, part of our analysis is patriarchy has harmed everyone. And so any person of any gender in our classes is going to have to deal with both that, you know, potential perpetration and potential victimization of it.
I have a question for you. You spoke a lot about people being referred to the classes. Recognize that they are being violent and abusive, or if they're, you know, kind of trying where you're going with the prevention aspect of it, how is that being shaped, and are people just coming from the community into wanting to take these classes, or is it always through law enforcement and that kind of thing? Because I always hear, especially now with being in, against sexual violence and all those different things, and they're saying, you know, teach the boys not to rape. And so not letting it get to you being a man doing something, what about when you're younger and
sure.
These things are being instilled in you? So how does that?
So I think there are two parts. So I'll start with the first. So we're nationally, classes like ours are almost completely dependent on the criminal legal system. And it's problematic for, you know, ways we can think of pretty quickly. We're working to set up referrals through other means. And so only about 50% of the men who come to us are referred to the criminal legal system. We get students sent to us through colleges. We have men who are sent, or I guess, find out about us through therapists or couples therapists or individual therapists. your second part of the question, I think that is where the movement is going for good reason. If we can change beliefs earlier, then we'll stop perpetration. But my experience, and I think it's instructive, is I used to work in a rape crisis center where I went into high schools and did primary prevention with high school students. And it was a bit overwhelming how much sexual harassment and inappropriate behavior I saw from teachers and coaches. And so what I really believe now is that we need to be doing both, but we need role models who are going to reinforce the things that we teach to young people. And when we don't have that, we're really not accomplishing much. And so that's where we've chosen to focus, is working with adults who will then be role models and reinforce teachings that young people are getting. Without that, we're sort of just putting band-aids on it, right?
While we're on the topic of young people, Marla, could you speak to any ideas for parents who are trying to raise sex-positive children?
I think being open and honest as possible around your children, I feel, with my experience with my own mother, being just sort of really a positive and very, you know, having the information always readily available, being open to answer any questions, being open to having their child, you know, ask questions, because sometimes I feel like parents might be a little scared of that. Yeah. But I really just trying to be as open and accepting as possible, and very much, like I said, leave it to like sort of general behavior and not pigeonholing, you know, your child into thinking that there's something, there might be something else. I think that's the way to go.
Professor Smith in the Religion Department, B. Smith. Thank you so much, panelists, for excellent, very literate and lucid presentations. Thank you. So I'm part of I teach in the Religion Department, and we have a lot of faith-based constituencies across religious traditions, not just Jewish, Christian, but Hindu and Buddhist and so on. And so I'm interested in what faith-based communities, from traditional churches to interfaith coalitions to New Age religious movements, could gain from your work. And earlier there was a question about how we got from shame-based sexuality to sex positivity, and I really appreciate your definition of it. But I'm not a historian, I'm a lousy historian, religion professor, but I actually am one of those baby boomers who lived through the so-called sexual revolution of the 60s. And it seems to me there's a missing analysis here, that we went from shame-based sexuality to kind of libertarian, or to free sex was one of the popular terms. And then there was a sharp conservative reaction and neoconservative reaction to that, which reinstalled, on top of liberative sex, reinstalled traditional patriarchal colonialist colonized sexuality. So we've got this kind of compounding going on, and it seems to me that sex positivity is a great antidote to that. But that it probably needs to be more sophisticated. That is, it's not just overcoming traditional, often religion-based sex sexuality, shame-based, guilt-based sexuality, but also this kind of reaction to free sex. And that then brings me to rhetoric and language for faith-based communities. Your focus on pleasure, freedom of choice, the embrace of new kinds of sexualities that cover the LGBTQI spectrum. To talk to traditional religionists in that context is going to require some skills some communication and translation skills.
Mm-hmm.
And I've specialized in that in my career. And so it seems to me one way to go would be to talk about the spirituality of sex positivity. Spirituality in which God, in which there are God realities, God beings, or God forces, the force, whatever, that celebrates human nature, the human body, the human capacity for not just pleasure, but sex is spiritually transformative. Often, this is one thing we've, in the West, we've learned from Eastern religious traditions, in which, though there's a Western form of this, in which sexuality is part of spiritual growth and development, spiritual transformation, illumination in life, through sexual being. It seems to me that's, I'm wanting to hear more of that in your sex positivity as well.
Yeah, definitely. So a couple of years ago, we had, my business partner and I, Tia, we had our first conference called the Sex Down South Conference, and that was actually our first subject of sexuality and spirituality. And being here in the South, right, being in Atlanta, being in the middle of the Bible Belt, how do we navigate this space of spirituality and sexuality? Now, I think they're totally intertwined. I think there's a way to talk to people. Like I was saying at the dinner, like I've done workshops for religious organizations, and it's because I was in tune, or I knew the Bible well enough to know what verses I needed to say or how I needed to navigate pleasure, desire, joy, instead of the stigma, shame, right? But you have to think about it in the context of maybe it's a couple's ministry. Right, so I can speak to the couples who are already married. But there is still a way to navigate, you know, sex positivity in those spaces. I don't think there is a connection there. You just have to know how to navigate it and to know a religion well enough to use those teachings and bring it in a way that helps to reinforce the goodness of sex.
Can I hear from the brother as well?
Oh, okay.
because some of this has to do with so-called toxic masculinities. I mean, you know, I'm thinking of you're very conservative, the evangelical men's movement that is called Promise Keepers. God wants you to keep your promise to be a faithful, caring father and husband, reliable, and not just a monster in the home. So. How would this work out with men's spirituality and the men's movement, which has spiritual dimensions?
Yeah, I mean, I think that movement in particular is really troubling. And talking about Trump, I see a lot of that being re-energized. Yeah, men's rights. I think the point that I really agreed with that you made earlier was sometimes there's an adoption of free sexuality without an analysis of patriarchy. So they feel like men are liberating themselves through practicing free sex, and maybe it is very liberatory. And so men in our classes sometimes are engaged in swinger communities or are experimenting with new sexual activities, but they're still doing it through a patriarchal lens. So it's not liberatory for their partners. And that's the place where it becomes really complicated because, again, we're in a group of men who come from traditional mindsets. We're an organization and a movement that comes from a very traditional position when it comes to sex, to feel like we need to not be critical of choices people are making around their sexuality at the same time as needing to interrogate how are these choices really just reinforcing the control you have in your relationship, and not very liberatory for your partners. And so that's an ongoing learning curve that we have. But again, like I said earlier, we're sort of being forced to grapple with that as we have men coming in with inviting these conversations.
Thank you.
So I'm going to gather the questions because we don't have much time, and we'll see which ones they'll answer. So you can ask your question.
Oh, I was just going to pull in a different component that hasn't really been discussed, and that's how the the whole socialization relating to patriarchy and whatnot, and how it impacts the lens through which women criticize other women, and how that impacts body positivity, sex positivity, and the like, and just it's amazing to hear about the work that Men Stopping Violence is doing. But as we think about that, we have to think about the filter, how it's filtered down to women, both the competitiveness, but also the body shaming and the slut shaming, and a lot of that is happening more from one woman to another than it is happening from a man to a woman in a lot of communities and spaces. And I just think that's an important component of this discussion, because as we think about how we can help to bring about more body positivity and sex positivity, we have to think about how we're impacting each other in those conversations as women. So I just wanted to say that.
My question was this notion of intersectionality. I have the great privilege of being in Kenya and working with really amazing young girls to talk about issues like sex positivity and body positivity and feminism in the continent of Africa, specifically in specific parts of Kenya. One of the things my students had a hard time grappling with is, on a daily basis, as they lived and breathed in the world, they had to prioritize defending their faith, defending their tribal affiliation, defending their nationality, defending their womanhood, defending their age, defending so many different parts of who they are that by the end of the day, quite literally, you're exhausted. And I did not know how, and I do not know how, what I could have said or could have done or could still do to make them feel more whole. Because at the end of the day, having to prioritize so many different parts and pick and choose at so many different parts of things that they already are, broke them. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know how you braid these strands for it to look cohesive and together.
Well, who are they being oppressed by? Mm-hmm. Who are these? Who are asking them these questions?
The teachers, the government officials.
The people who have power.
Yeah, each other.
It's tiring. It's tiring. I feel like for me as a Black queer woman, it's tiring. You know, if you have to sit here and answer, I've had people not understand or believe in what I say because of who I am. And I have to constantly defend myself with my degrees. I don't want to do that. If I talk to you as a human being, I want to be able to give my idea to you and you acknowledge that, not depend on something that I've accomplished or achieved. It's tiring, so I totally get why they're tired. And how to help that, I'm not sure if it's necessarily something you can do, but I think there is a way that you can use your privilege and to talk to those leaders who are in power, those people who are oppressing them, and say, hey, I think you should talk to them like this, or I have a suggestion. This is what they're saying to me. They're tired because you're asking them about their age, about their religion, and they're feeling defensive. I think there's a way to navigate your own privilege and use that to help folks who are marginalized.
I'm going to end on a final question, and then we're going to go over to the reception so y'all can ask them. But we did this whole thing on making love, and so I want to end on a positive note and ask you, how do you construct love? How do we make love? What's love got to
do? Go ahead. I was really touched by the quotes that were read at the beginning of this panel. And I think the quote by Bell Hooks talking about love and liberation, I think that's why I feel. And it's both, it's an ideal that I strive for. I think of working in liberatory movements as the most loving act that I can do. And at the same time, I'm someone who always focuses on the problems. You know, so I'll break down, you know, what's wrong with our society much quicker than I'll tell you about what's right about it. And I think hearing that quote is really an important about liberation and think about what we're building, and know that love is at the center of that. That's important for me.
For me, I think about, when I think about like making love, creating love, you have to ask yourself, what gives you joy? What gives you pleasure? What makes you happy, right? Because I think doing those things helps you and your energy to vibrate love. When you vibrate love, other people are touched by that love. And so I think the out of the negativity comes opportunity. So with those opportunities, using those opportunities as positives to create more love and put more love out there.
So I thank both of you, Marla and Lee. Thank you for being here today. Thank all of you for coming out today, and please enjoy the reception.